So we have been discussing this online convex optimization problem, but then we saw that if we just follow the regularized reader, for if follow the leader, in some cases we may end up with bad regret. We showed with an example when my function was linear. Then we showed that if you somehow regularize it, things can be better, and but you have to choose the regularizers appropriately. Okay, so for the case when we have my loss functions defined to be like this, and when we use our regularizer to be what, 1 by eta times norm of, I think there was a 2 here, right? We showed that we get a simple update mechanism, which was basically a gradient descent, that you update your weights taking into account the gradients in each step, and you will account your gradients in such a way that your weights will decrease according to the gradients, not simply the gradient, some eta times the gradient. So based on that, we had this simple online gradient descent algorithm. Which was like, we start with parameter eta, posit u, then shear lies with w1, which is 0 vector, then your update rule was w of s1 is w2 minus eta times zt, and what is the zt here? The zt is the, we say that this is the subgradient computed at wt. Okay. And if the function f was differentiable, then we say this is simply the derivative at that point, in which case the derivative here is simply this zt here, right? Okay, fine. And for this algorithm, what did the bound we showed finally? We had for this setup, we had shown that the regret with respect to n was upper bounded by. So we had something like, what was that? 2 eta norm of u square plus summation t equals to 1 to t, then norm of z square, is that correct? There is an eta here. Okay, so then we made an assumption here. We said that let's say norm of this is upper bounded by beta, and also said that let's say the subgradients are upper bounded by this L. Then this upper bound turned out to be 2 eta b plus eta times ln. After this, what we did? We optimized this over eta, because that eta was an input parameter, and by appropriate choice of eta, what is the final bound we got? The best upper bound. Root over 2b ln. Okay, now from this expression, as you see, the regret is dependent on the size of this gradients here, right? somehow, if whatever you are choosing, if these gradients have to be very large, then your regret is also going to be large. So that's why we assume that, okay, the gradients could be anything, but we ensure that they are bounded. Adversary can't choose any arbitrary gradient. It has to be limited like this, and with that we got this bound. So it looks like to get a good bound, one has to control these gradient levels. Now we will see that these gradients can also be thought of course, this is a property of your function f, but we can now going to connect it to the Lipschitz property of a function. So now we are going to make a little bit detour and do some notations. So we are going to call f is L Lipschitz. If you take, so I am going to assume this functions f are all real functions, real valued functions. So if you take the difference between this function f at the points x and y, this should be upper bounded by L times this. Okay. And now you see that I have taken this to be real valued function, but this real valued function takes argument to be vectors. X and y could be any vector. And if this is like for all x, y, and this L is a constant, this does not depend on what is the value of x and y here. And now you see that I have written this x minus y, and I am interested in some norm of this, right? What is this? How is this norm defined? Okay, right now I am going to say f is L Lipschitz with respect to norm. Now I am going to define this, whatever this operator. Now right now just think it as an operator. Okay, this operator is this. If you tell me this norm and you are going to say your function is L Lipschitz with respect to that norm, then this is what I mean. This is the definition. Okay, now what is the norms we are interested in? In general, if you have a x, a p norm is defined as summation xi to the power p, this whole to the power 1 by p. Okay. So what is, if p is equals to 1, we are going to call it as L1 norm. How does L1 norm look like? So L1 norm is like so it is simply going to be summation of absolute value of individual components. Okay. Now if you take, suppose p equals to 2, this is called L2 norm. And how does this look like? This is the one and this is squared of this. Sorry, just this, right? And this is the one which we are most familiar with, right? This is called L2 norm. And in general, any norm with this parameter p is defined to be this. Okay. And I mean, we are going to denote a generic norm . So when I say this, I have here, I am just intend to say this is a norm of vector x, but I have not clearly specified whether this is a L1 norm, L2 norm or pth norm. Okay. So, this is just to denote this is a norm with respect to some p, and depending on what is that we are interested in, we are going to say this is going to be L1 norm or L2 norm. Okay. That is basically in this we have not specified the value of p. Depending on what is value of our p, we will say p is 1 or 2. So, there is a notion of dual norm. So, this is a generic norm. So, if you give me a norm, whatever x, its dual norm, I am going to define it as and I am going to substitute it as like this. So, take any generic norm that has been given to you. Okay. Now, I am going to define its dual norm. How I am going to define? Its value is going to be max of this inner product. This is clear what we mean by this, over all w such that this happens. Suppose I am interested in finding the dual norm of L1, then this guy is going to be simply L1 here. Okay. And now, if I am going to be interested in dual norm of L2, in that case we have to take this to be with L2. Okay. So, if this is the generic definition of dual norm, when you have given a general norm, whatever it is. Okay. So, you can verify, I am just leaving you, if I have WZ two things, this can be always upper bounded as norm of W and norm of its dual norm. Suppose if you take inner product of two quantities W and Z, the first whatever the generic norm you have, let us say this is L1 norm, then the second term is the dual of that L1 norm. So, here the dual corresponds to what are the associated generic norm. So, if this guy is L2 norm, here when I say this is the associated dual norm of L2. Okay. So, here you see that I can interchange W and Z, right. So, here I could write it as Z and here I could write it as W, in which case I am taking the generic norm with on W here and its dual norm on Z here. Okay. So, in most of our analysis we will be only interested in mostly P1 and P2, okay. But it so happens that if you have PQ greater than or equals to 1 such that 1 by p plus 1 by q is equals to 1, if this happens, then, so I am just going to call this as like L1 norm and this is like L2 norm here and this is like LP norm. Then LP and LQ norms are dual. Okay. So, if you are going to take LQ norm, its dual norm will be given by Q if 1 by P plus 1 by Q satisfies this. Okay. So suppose now let's do this. Suppose I want to take P to be 1. So that is L1, and then what is the Q that is going to satisfy this equation? If I take P equals to 1, what is the value of Q that satisfies this equation? Infinity, right? So dual of L1 norm is what? L infinity norm. Okay, now let's define what is L infinity norm. So by definition, L infinity norm is, this is xi to the power infinity and then take 1 by infinity power. I mean, the way to interpret that is simply max of I if the maximum component among them. Okay, and just think of intuitively, like if you are raising this to power infinity and then taking this to be 1 by that power. So if you let P to go to infinity, what is this power is converging to 0, right? And then in this case, the one with the largest value dominate. So that is why you can argue that this definition just turns out to be this max of this component when by letting P go tending to infinity. Okay. The other thing is, so now let's take L2. If I take P equals to 2, what is the value of Q that satisfies this equation? 2. So if my generic norm is L2, what is this dual norm? Is again L2. So L2 norm is dual of itself. Okay. So that's why so L2 norm is the most simpler to handle. I really don't need to, if I just say L2 norm, I need not worry whether I am working in the original norm space or I am in the dual space. Okay. Okay, with this, that's why L2 and so here, that is why it is important that whenever I am going to define my Lipschitzness with respect to a norm, that matters, because it could be L1, L2, L3, whatever, and depending on that, this L could change. This may satisfy this for some L1 if it is L1 norm, and if I am going to take this to be a L2 norm, this L could be different, right? Okay, fine. Okay, so this, with this notation, now let's move back to what we are interested in. We were interested in the fact that these ZTs here, which are subgradients, we wanted them to be bounded. Now, is this subgradient somehow related to the Lipschitzness of this function? And if that is the case, with what parameter? So here to make all these things work, to get this sublinear bound, I needed this condition, right? That all the subgradients are upper bounded by that. Is it that equivalent to saying my function is L Lipschitz? Is that true? So we will see that, yes, that is true. So here is the result. I'm just going to state it. We will skip the proof. So let my f is a real valued function from S to R be convex. Then we are going to say that then F is L Lipschitz. So this basically states that if I have a convex function and a real function, and this is Lipschitz with respect to some norm, okay. And this is if and only if for every point in S and all the associated gradients, subgradients, this satisfies. That is, in this great subgradients in the dual space, they are also upper bounded by L. So, if my, so in a way, what we are saying is if my function is L Lipschitz, then my subgradients are also upper bounded by L, okay. So, now let us take this norm to be L2 norm, okay. Then this is also, we know that this is also L2 norm. If my function here, let us say, is L Lipschitz with respect to L2 norm, then all the subgradients should be also uniformly bounded by that same constant L. So, in a way, what are all the stuff we did here, everything here works out. Instead of saying that my gradients here, subgradients are the dual norms of subgradients are upper bounded by L, instead of this, if I say my function f, the f1, f2 that I am going to see, they are all L Lipschitz, then everything goes through here, right, okay. So, henceforth, that is why now instead of worrying about my gradients are the subgradients are bounded in the dual space, I just worry about whether my function is Lipschitz in the generic norm, okay. So, henceforth, that is why I am only interested now. Henceforth, I will focus on whether my function is Lipschitz, or I will assume that my functions are Lipschitz with some constant, that automatically implies that my subgrades are also Lipschitz. So, just notice here one small thing, like when I derive out all these things, I assume that the squared norm are upper bounded by L, but here when I convert it to this, this is just dual norm, so there is no square here. So, basically then we henceforth we have to replace our L by square root L, that is the translation we have to do, okay. Or maybe what I should have done is when I wrote all these things, instead of that, maybe I should have considered this value and put all the things, but anyway, let us not worry about. So, we will just keep in mind that there is a square root L translation we have to do when we have to compare our bounds with whatever I achieved here. So, far what we did, we all these things nicely worked out when we have a specific regularizer, right. What was that regularizer? The regularizer we defined was R of u was 1 by eta to eta, okay. So, this is the specific regularizer we took, and this regularizer was defined. So, is this regularizer here, was it a convex function with respect to, so like when you, this of course, it is a convex function, was it a Lipschitz? So, just see if I take f equals to r here, is it a Lipschitz? And if it is Lipschitz, you have to tell me for what L and with what norm, okay. So, just plug in, if you are just going to plug r here and just simplify, what is that you are going to get, okay. Let us do that. So, this is, I am going to get it as 1 upon 2 eta. Norm of 2, sorry, x here minus 1 upon 2 eta okay. So anyway, this is already out, right? Like this is 1 upon 2 eta is a constant. This is right. So, can you simplify this any further? Okay, what is the definition of this? Norm of x whole square. So, norm of summation of xi square, and this is summation of yi square. This is written as less than. Plus and minus. Why is this true? Okay, so this term here we actually get, so if I just take it directly, so this term is nothing but whatever the components, right? Because of this, okay, you have split this. But what I want is here this. So what is the this definition here? If I am going to take it to be in L2 norm, what I want is this is nothing but summation xi yi square under root of this whole square. But what I have here is only x square minus y square. Okay, is x square minus y square is upper bounded by xi minus yi whole square. So check out that this is indeed, you can simplify this and you can get it as whatever this 1 by 2 eta norm of x minus y this whole square. Just simplify, expand this, try to get this xi minus yi square stuff in terms of x minus y whole square summation. Then you will end up something which you can write in terms of the norm of difference between x minus y. Okay. So, what we have actually is this function here is indeed Lipschitz and whatever the constant we have in front of it, that is 1 by 2 eta here. Okay. This one. So, this is you just apply the definition whatever, like okay, what is this, what we want norm of x minus y, right, and you want it to be L2. What is this is going to be? I am saying you just have to simplify it, right. So, you have to manipulate that and apply some inequality to get that. Right, this is not the final step, I am skipping the step to work it out for you. Okay. So, you complete this. So, we have one regularizing function here which is convex. We can look at other regularizers as well, right, which we want. Anyway, this regularizing function was convex, that is a good, because I was adding this regularization function to the sum of convex functions, right. and I was minimizing it. So if I'm adding this regularizing function to the sum of convex function, if this regularizer is also a convex function, then the whole function is convex for me, and it's easier for me to minimize this. Fine, that property I desire. Now what we are saying is, in addition to this, we would also like this, all of this FT functions to be Lipschitz, right? Then we are going to get this. But R, the regularization function we have, we are also thought it as convex function, which I got it in the 0th round, right? The way we treated R is like F0. So we also want it to be also Lipschitz with some constant, right? So now let us look at, if I are going to consider other regularizing functions, maybe let us say both convex and Lipschitz, what kind of bound one can expect, and what are the other possibilities we have. Okay, so we would be interested in something like more, what is going to call as some functions which are strongly convex, not just convex, but something more than that, and for that we will be able to derive some better bounds.